In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. So, here we are, the first night of the evening Bascha, and like I said, I know it's a lot, a long day, and it's tough, but like I said, also Saturday night, you're not going to get much sympathy from me. This is not the week of taking it easy. This is the week to push through. It's the week to push through. And like we said, Saturday night, it's the week of cost. It costs something, and it might be hopefully not our sanity, but maybe just our time and maybe some of our effort and everything. So I'm excited this year. We're going to go through, I know we all know the story. But want to get deeper into kind of like understanding and setting the table, honestly, for Friday. Like, we know what happens, you know, like Palm Sunday comes in, we walk through some of the major events that, you know, we've all been taught maybe in our Sunday schools. And then we kind of all of a sudden, you know, are washing the feet and then having communion, and then it's Good Friday. But let's go through a little bit and kind of just understanding, like, what was going on at that time. So many things can be said about Jesus, of course. Like, here he is, right? He's loving, he's kind, he's gentle, he's a great teacher, he does lots of miracles, he's patient, he's pure, he's blameless, he's merciful, he's forgiving, he doesn't judge anybody, he's calm, he's a savior, and he's the Son of God. And then we get, like, all these icons, these beautiful icons of who he is. Like, why would they want to kill this person? Look at this list. Look at the list and take out one of these words. You can't. Who would want to kill him? So that's what we want to try to figure out. Like, what's going on? Like, is there some kind of conspiracy? Is there, like, what is going on that there's this perfect man, literally, and then all of a sudden somebody wants to kill him? So let's start by, just understanding, where are we getting all this information from? Just to understand, like, some of the things. Where are we getting it from? One obvious one. Where are we getting all our information? The Gospels, right? It's a written account. How many? Just one? We have four. Let's not take that very lightly, all right? They didn't conspire with each other, and you can tell. I don't know if you noticed, we read four today, right? Not only two out of the four mention, like, the donkey and the colt. But the other two kind of just, you know, were focused on something else. It's not, like, if they were having a conspiracy, all of them would have, like, every little detail. It's like, let's collaborate. Let's make sure nobody has, you know, like, you know how the lawyers are. They're going to pick point. They're going to say, look, he said this, and it's not credible. But they were all different. Also, they all bring their element as well. The other thing, what else did we have beside the four Gospels? Something that you really value, especially in the court of law. Think of all the law. Yeah, absolute eyewitnesses. People saw what was going on. So there was four people that wrote. But I don't know, thousands that saw, right? What else? These are credible sources. So you got the four Gospels, right? What else? Sorry? Yes. Yes. Throw away, you know, like, the information of the Gospel. We have history. Like, there were actual Jews. Like, you know, like, you figure, like, Jewish people would kind of change the story because of, you know, we'll talk about it in a second, but we have them too. They were credible sources of what's going on. Anything else you can think of? Actually, you got them all. There's one more. Yeah. Artifacts, but who else wrote other things? The other, like, you know, the St. Paul's, the St. Peter, the James, like, their writings are very consistent with the Gospels. as well. So exactly, you name them all. So many people wrote, and there's other credible sources out there. So just understand, in terms of where we're getting information, it's not like just, you know, somebody told, you know, Martha, and Martha told May, and May told Elizabeth, and, you know, there's a little bit more substance to where we got all our stuff. So just so that, again, we're not just like, are we sure this is happening? Look at all these credible sources. We're trying to, who killed Jesus? Now we're fast-forwarding a little bit, and we'll come back. Who killed Jesus? So the Romans and the Jews. So you're kind of both right. Right? Technically, the Romans, right? Because the Jews can't commit somebody. But of course, it was the Jews that were behind it, right? I mean, we'll see a little bit. They were the masterminds. They were the ones that had, all the story, and they were pushing Rome, because Rome is the only one that can crucify, that can kill. So who killed them? Yes, the Romans technically, but the Jews were the masterminds. And again, when we say this, you know, again, we're not being, you know, anti-Semitic or anything like that. We're just saying what history was based on all the writings that we have. But why? It still doesn't make sense. You know, I'm not going to go back to that slide. We got a loving, kind, merciful Savior. And they were waiting for this, right? All the prophecies. They said they were waiting for the Messiah. It's not like, hey, who's this guy? They were waiting for a Messiah. They were saying, hey, we've been waiting, thousands of years waiting for a Messiah to come. And they knew, you got to be impressed with how much they've memorized. They memorized everything, right? So they knew. It's not like, oh, they missed that verse. They didn't all miss the verse of he shall be conceived from a virgin, about him being born in Bethlehem, about all the things that was mentioned, especially in Isaiah. And they knew Isaiah. They knew Isaiah very, very well. They knew that he was going to be from the lineage of David. They knew that he was going to be serving others, that he's going to form a new covenant. There's going to be, I will pour a new spirit. I will pour my spirit and make a new heart within you. That you knew that the Spirit of the Lord was going to be upon him, and they knew that he was going to have wonders. And all this is in Isaiah. A lot of these are in Isaiah, and they knew Isaiah. They knew it. And at the time, you know, again, just as a reminder, just history, Rome was the world power at that time. Rome, the Romans, it was their empire. That was their time to shine. Before that, it was the Greeks, right? Alexander the Great. But then Rome took over for a while. All right. Let's go back to Jesus. So Jesus, why? I mean, he was the rabbi. He was a teacher. He was, call him a good teacher. But he did a few things. He touched the lepers. Ooh. He touched the dead. Ooh, ooh. He healed on the Sabbath. Ooh, ooh, ooh. He had dinner with sinners and tax collectors and harlots. This can't be the Messiah. In their eyes, no way. No way can that happen. Actually, they even said, where does he do his miracles? His miracles are from Satan. And Jesus, if you remember that, that's one of our Sunday Gospels, right? Jesus said, that's ridiculous. How can Satan cast out Satan? If you're saying, I'm Satan, why would I beat up my own demons? It just, even logic doesn't make sense, right? The Pharisees were meticulous on the minor observance of the law, right? And they ignored the big stuff, healing on the Sabbath, touching a dead person, and touching him to raise him, right? And healing, the person so many healings on the Sabbath. And he insisted to do it on Sabbath because he wanted them to look at the bigger picture, mercy is above just the little observance of the law. They said, we don't want him. We don't want this guy. We don't want this guy. There's three main catalysts, and let's kind of go through them quickly. Here's we're setting the table for Friday here. Like, what is going on? How did we go from feeding the multitudes, raising Lazarus, you know, healing the blind, to let's get rid of him? And they were successful. So the first catalyst was the raising of Lazarus. This is like, even until then, even when we did processions, I said there was many processions as of Saturday night onwards. Like, processions have been historical in our, like, they do many processions, or their processions are always outside. We barely do them outside. Actually, most churches don't even do anything outside, right? Like, but most of them were like from getting one place to another. And you can see a lot of people do it. I don't know if you've seen, you know, if you've seen some of the Palm Sunday from last week from like places, you know, like in Europe where they're very still, like, the holidays are holy days. Holidays are holy days. And they're all outside in the streets procession on Palm Sunday. That's the normal. So here this was a big deal. And like, again, we link that resurrection to Christ's resurrection. And all of a sudden, he was a threat to their power. This is the first catalyst. This was big. This was big. When he raised Lazarus, this made some big noise. Like, people started to say, wow, like this person is amazing. Like, this person is the Messiah. And it got their attention. And right away, they thought that, like, he was going to be a threat, and that Rome, see, there's a lot of, unfortunately, even back then, or maybe always in the history, there's always politics. Politics rules. They had power. It says, like, Rome left them alone. As long as you are peaceful, we'll give you power. And they had, as long as Rome gave them power, we'll do whatever you want. And that's the deal. And Jesus was a threat to that. And that's the first catalyst. Let's read. We're going to read a little bit about these three situations. So in Lazarus, many of the Jews had come to Mary and had seen the things that Jesus did and believed in him. This is, like I said, this is big because now they started to believe in him. But some of them went away to the Pharisees and told them the things Jesus did. Tattletales. Tattletales. It's like, okay, let's go tell our bosses. Let's go tell the leaders. Let's keep them informed of what's going on. Remember, this is the first catalyst. This is what starts the ball rolling. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together a council and said, "What shall we do? For this man works many signs. If we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him. But so what? That's good. Not to them. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and nation." You see how the pieces are starting to put in? He's a threat. He's a threat to their power. They killed somebody because he was a threat to their power. And one of them, Caiaphas, being high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you consider that it is expedient for us that one should die for the people, and not the whole nation perish." Now this he did not say on his own authority, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also that he would gather together in one of the children of God who was scattered abroad. And from that day on, here's the catalyst, from that day on, they plotted to put him to death. Like I said, Lazarus was a big deal. This was a big deal. And this was starting you know, they were kind of like observing, and then now many believe, many start following, they plotted to kill him. Therefore, Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there into the country near the wilderness to a city called Ephraim, and there remained with his disciples And the Passover of the Jews was near, and many went from the country up to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. Then he sought Jesus and spoke among themselves as they stood in the temple, "What do you think, that he will not come to the feast?" So they were looking for him and trying to seize him at the end. Second catalyst. Second catalyst is this morning. Is the entry into Jerusalem, right? So first of all, this is now like incidents, a couple of incidents just like days apart. So a great many of the Jews knew that he was there, but they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests plotted to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. See, they're blaming, they blame the guy from being raised from the dead. Like, here's a guy in the tomb, and somebody raised me from the dead, and they want to kill that guy. He's not even involved. But that's how bad. It's like, oh my God, this guy actually rose from the dead. Let's kill him. So the next day, a great multitude had come to the feast. When they heard that Jesus was coming to the Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees, went out to meet him, and cried, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." This was big again. You could see now, like, he's getting followers, right? Now he rose Lazarus from the dead. He's coming to Jerusalem, Palm Sunday, and now people are putting branches, putting on their clothes, and crying out, "Hosanna." And this is, everybody is seeing this. Second catalyst. The third catalyst. Third catalyst is also what happened on this day, is the cleansing of the temple. Now talk about making enemies, right? Like, here is the temple. Let's talk and pause a little bit about the temple. The temple is this glorious building. If anybody's seen it, anybody's been there, or like, actually whatever's there is not even compared to the glory of David and Solomon's time, right? It was destroyed in 586 and rebuilt in 520. So, and people cried when it was rebuilt, not because of joy, but because they couldn't believe how bad that 520 BC temple was versus the golden age of David. Like, again, when you read about it in Kings and all the materials, the cedars, the gold, like, silver was nothing in those days. That was destroyed. That was destroyed, and it was rebuilt, but in nothing like the glory and the splendor of Solomon's. But when we think of temple, we think of church, right? Holy, it's quiet, people are peaceful. The temple is nothing like that. The temple is very noisy, very busy, very, like, people are exchanging money, and especially on the feast, and this was Passover, especially on the feast. But, like, this was a very happening place, you know, and this is the temple. This is the temple. Yes, they had readings, prayers, you know, and sacrifices, but business is dry. I don't know why, but I guess people needed haircuts too, but the doctors and the barbers thrived, especially in the feast. I guess people came for their haircuts at the same time as their sacrifices, maybe go check out, you know, my knee hurts, I don't know. And at that time, King Herod was in the middle of an expansion. So, built in roughly 1000, destroyed in 586, rebuilt in 520, and then right around the zero, right on King Herod, he basically had an expansion to basically make it bigger and more glorious. That took about 80 years. So that's at that time of Christ as well. And not everybody can enter the temple, right? You have to be Jewish. And so that's one of the things that was happening at that time. So, of course, as we read today at the temple, the noise, the money exchange, actually not even, if they only changed money, that's one thing, but they were, like, stealing, they were ripping people off, they were, you know, the animals were in a place of holy, you know, places where they shouldn't, and Jesus is basically saying, you know, a temple, you know, the temple is not only made with hands. So it's not like just this busy place that you are, like, thinking that it's the Mecca of everything. Jesus said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And of course he was talking about, as we talked about in the sermon today, the temple of the body. Destroy the body and I will rise in 3 days. So, by the way, as a little aside, because, you know, because on Friday, the witnesses are wrongly accusing Jesus of saying, I will destroy the temple. He never said that, by the way. He never said that. He said, if destroy the temple and I will raise it. He didn't say, I will destroy it. Just a little. So Jesus is the temple. Those are the three catalysts. Those are the three catalysts. Let's end on this slide. What about me? What am I being? Like, we see this as ridiculous. Like, the raising of Lazarus, like, really, really? Well, do we see also certain threats? Do we see that Jesus maybe is a threat to my own life? Like, I don't know. I don't want maybe Jesus as part of that life because I don't want to change that part of my life. I don't want Jesus to come in. Maybe he's going to threaten, you know, that means I have to change things. That means I might have to behave differently. That means I might not be able to do certain things. So this week is about us, right? We're taking everything, obviously, from what happened historically, but applying it to us. And do we see Jesus as a threat to him changing my life? We all say, Jesus changed my life, but do we mean it? Or do we think it as a threat, like they did, and said, no, I want my power. I don't want Jesus. I don't want the Messiah. I want my power. I want my prestige. I want people to call me rabbi. I want people to come and bow down. I want people to always ask me for advice. They see it as a threat. Do I see things like Jesus coming? Because he will come, and he will make differences if I make him king, if I let him reign, if I let him be the ruler of my life. But he has to rule. Unless I see him as a threat, and then he won't rule. The second catalyst, we saw that they were jealous. That, oh my goodness, everybody's following him. Do we see this in my life now? Do I see that all of a sudden, you know, it's why are they coming? Why is Jesus, you know, if I invite Jesus, maybe there's going to be some jealousy. Maybe there's some jealousy in terms of my own life, my own, like, behavior again as well, and not have the same thing. Is he going to come? Am I going to be jealous of maybe certain things of other people? That they, you know, all of a sudden it's a matter of envy, especially like maybe in you know, very much so in social media. And I see things and I'm very covetous and I'm very envious and I'm very wanting somebody else. And I don't look at it as a great thing for somebody else, but I'm jealous. I'm jealous. And the third catalyst is the noise and the busyness. That is one, again, that Jesus wants to come. But he goes, you're too, like this temple, remember the temple is the body. That's what he said. The temple is what I'm going to raise in 3 days. So the temple, our bodies, is the temple. Is it full of noise? Is it full of busyness? Because if it is, then how is Jesus going to be our Messiah? If I don't allow him some quiet time, if I don't allow him some time that he can whisper. He likes to whisper. He doesn't like to yell. If I don't allow it, then I'm doing the same thing. I'm not really, you know, I'm hate to say it, I'm killing Jesus. I'm getting ready to plot against him and killing him because I'm not allowing him in. And I say, no. No, you can't come in. Maybe I'm doing it. I'm not doing it in a purposeful way. But I'm doing it by just by behavior, just being totally busy, just noise. TV is always on, computer is always on, cars, like there's never any kind of silence and there's never any downtime in my life. And that's, maybe I never look at that as I'm plotting to kill Jesus, but I'm never letting him in. So if I'm not letting him in, he's not living in my life, therefore he's dead. Therefore he's dying. So let's be careful. Let's be careful that these three, we'll continue all week, kind of like looking at the history. Tomorrow will be something else, because we hear about all these, we hear about priests and chief priests and scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees and Sanhedrin. So tomorrow we'll talk about those guys as well. But for today, let's look at these three catalysts. The one that basically ended up killing Jesus. And if they are in my life, then maybe Jesus doesn't, again, I'm doing it by, I'm doing it maybe indirectly. Like, he's not coming in, and if he's not coming in, then he's not alive. And glory be to God forever. Christ, I stand.